We'll move right into our second presentation for the day. Today, we'll be hearing from Christina Bard and Chithra Adams.
Yes. Well, thank you, Anne, for the lovely introduction. Thank you for the Center for Knowledge Translation for Disability and Rehabilitation Research for inviting us to this conference. We are excited to be here. As Anne mentioned, Christina and I are at the Human Development Institute, which is housed within the University of Kentucky. The Human Development Institute does research, evaluation, technical assistance, direct service, and trainings on a variety of lifespan issues as it relates to disability. Thank you. So we have two big focus areas for our presentation. I'm going to be talking about the strategies that can be used across the research and knowledge translation continuum as it relates to using social media, and how do you manage a social media presence, that is compatible with the other things that's going on in your work. And Christina is going to talk about the ways to make social media messaging accessible and evaluate social media use. A bit of introduction about myself, because this is very relevant to talk about when we talk about social media. I do program evaluation and community-based research. So my professional interests are evaluation practice, programs, theory, disability advocacy, design thinking, tech and big data. My personal interests are listening to podcasts and reading reviews. My social media reflects this professional and personal interest. So I follow everyone, I follow people who have very similar interests. For me, social media is a venue to keep up with the discourse that's happening in all these topical areas. I know Katya did a similar poll, but I think it's worthwhile to do this question again. Shoshana, can you pull up the first poll question, please? So which of the social media platforms do you primarily use, either professionally or personally? I see the chat box, someone has posted LinkedIn. Thank you. That's certainly a very important social media platform. So yes, there's a question of why does it let me pick one? So I wanted to know what was the primary, but I think we can close the poll. So we have about 45% who are using Facebook and about 27% who are using Twitter. Then we saw people who are using, who said that they use multiple platforms and LinkedIn. So some of the things that I'm going to be talking about are going to be relevant across all platforms, and sometimes it's going to be specific about Twitter. So when I'm going to be talking about social media, I'm specifically going to talking about my experience using Twitter. And it has a similar, it has similar features like other platforms. But I want to make sure that I contextualize my experience within this one particular platform. Before I jump into talking about social media, I think it's worthwhile to note, and we all know this, that social media platforms and their algorithms incentivize engagement. Not all types of engagement are good. There are, definitely certain attention-seeking behaviors that don't lead to productive engagement. So I would like to note that it's important to note the importance of the rules of engagement within each social media platform. Different social media platforms have different rules, and most of them are very implicit. So, for example, tagging in Twitter you have to know when to tag someone in Twitter. When do you bring someone to a conversation? When do you don't? And these implicit rules of engagement are really important, and it's important to understand them. They're very much a certain norm of communication. Women, especially women of color, are treated unfairly and routinely harassed. So it's important that we know how to, how the rules of communication are and how to safely amplify and engage with collaborators. It is also a thought, it's a point in time. It is definitely people's choice to keep their social media messages permanent. There are software programs that help people delete it, help delete tweets and posts. And it's, we have to understand the transient nature of social media. One thing I've learned is there are some people who are really good at disseminating information, that they do it very well, and they become a central source of the recent discourse. So if you find such people, it's important to be a patron of their good content. So if they have a newsletter, subscribe to their newsletter. If they have a Patreon account, subscribe to their Patreon account. Because most of the work done on social media is often unpaid. Most of the good discourse, most of the good conversation that's happening is often an unpaid labor. So it has good consumers of information, we have to be sure that we are being patrons of good content and people who are bringing in the real dialogue in. I use social media to make my research inclusive and to have a pulse on the current discourse. I use it a way to engage with people who have very diverse perspectives on an issue. It also allows me to be a part of network. As Anne mentioned, I evaluate programs across different content areas, and an easy way for me to understand the nuance within each content area is to have a network of people who are talking about it, who are impacted by it. It also helps me recognize my own blind spots when I think through an issue. Social media platform has actually provided people who have traditionally been excluded from the academic world of publication. So it has really brought a platform for people who are outside the academic atmosphere and, start giving them a way to synthesize their thoughts and opinions on issues that are very pertinent to all of us. Social media is, I use social media also for participant recruitment. And like everyone else, for disseminating and amplifying and promoting messages. I would like to make a disclaimer that I'm neither a content creator nor a public intellectual. What I mean by this is I do not, I don't take an article and discuss the implications of it, either policy-wise or, societal-wise. It is, that's a lot of heavy lifting work. I don't take up an issue and look at it in a particular framework or a lens in a very public platform. I'm not a public intellectual, nor do I post content often. I really use it as a complementary source of information for my own practice and research. Shoshana, can you post the second, the third poll question, please? So the poll question is, do you use social media for knowledge translation purposes? Thank you. Can we close the poll, please? Excellent. So a good 65% of you all use social media for knowledge translation purposes. I think this will really lead to a very rich conversation after the presentation on how this tool can be, how social media can further enhance. So social media can be used across the knowledge translation continuum. It can be used from inquiry to synthesis, a selection of tools and in my experience, I use social media for different phases for different projects. I don't use it consistently across all projects. It's, where applicable and when applicable depends on the phase. That's when I use social media. There are different knowledge translation phases. The knowledge translation, framework by Strauss et al. Is very common. And I think it really is, it gives us a lot of room and discretion on how we want to use. So the first step of, the first step in creating a knowledge in using social media is, let's think about, is creating your list. Who are the people you're going to follow? And this is basically creating your own group based on your interest. And you can create a number of lists based on the number of interests you have. It doesn't have to be one big list that makes it. But these are the people whom you who are going to populate your Twitter timeline, who are going to populate your LinkedIn timeline. And these are the people whose work you're going to retweet, like, share, and amplify. Once you create this, it's almost like you're having a backup. It's almost like you're having a virtual research team with you on social media. So once you have your virtual research team, I really use social media for studying the problem, because what it has allowed me to do, it has allowed me to look at an issue from the people who are most impacted by it. For example, if you're interested in housing, it is social media gives you a venue to study the issue from people who are either houseless or have or are in precarious situations of housing. And it leads you to understand and be empathetic to their situation. For example, you know, some of the common terminologies we use for someone who does not have shelter is homeless. But what I figured out is most people who are without a shelter or stable housing prefer the term houseless. They might have a home, it's just that they don't have a physical place to be in. And that's the kind of thing, that's the kind of thing you learn when you are in social media, when you're in a social media platform. The next is people who are studying the issue. These could be renowned scholars, these could be well-known practitioners, but these could also be emerging scholars, students who are grappling with and who are in their who are grappling with their new research. I've always found the students, especially the new graduate students, because they're so well versed with social media, it's very common for them to read an article and post their discourse and post their thoughts. They're also a great source of information for new literature that's out there. So I'm one of those people who follows everyone who is actively posting on an issue. It's also good to follow organizations who are regulating funding the issue and who are regulating and funding the policy. You know, just making a getting the policy context is really important as well. And we have, and again, has things, make sure your list or the group of people you follow is diverse and inclusive. I cannot stress this enough, because we all know that we have these inherent biases, whether in research or publication, to promote a certain kind. But, not everyone has access to those traditional methods. What social media does is it gives platform to really a diverse and inclusive set of people who are impacted by various issues. I really use social media to understand how sense making is done, how the discourse is moving. Because people are thinking through in real time, it of course does not have the it does not have all the complete nuance and the comprehensiveness that you might find in a traditional literature review. And I'm not saying one should replace the other, but rather it's very complementary. Because you can, you know, if you're coming with a background set of assumptions or a background set of literature, then you have following this active online discourse on how sense is made or how reality is viewed, gives you a really complete picture. So it's a very crucial part, or it can form a crucial part when you think about the inquiry phase, or when you think about the study problem defining space or the scope space. So Shauna, can you put the last poll, please? Does your organization have an active social media account? Thank you, Shauna. Can I see the results? Wow, a good majority, 90% of y'all's organization has an active social media account. This is important. Thank you. We can close the poll. And this is where it's important to leverage an organizational social media account. So it's important to note that my personal account, it's like, you know, it's high. I really pay attention to it on weekend nights, but then on days, you know, when I have a full schedule, I don't manage it. Like, I'm not actively keeping track of it. This is where you have to engage with and learn how to work with organizational social media accounts. As I've mentioned, and my apologies for the clicking, I'm not sure what's going on. So this is where we have to leverage your organizational social media account. As I said, I'm a part of the Human Development. I'm a staff member of the Human Development Institute, and which is housed within the University of Kentucky. So there are two organizational accounts that I leverage with. I leverage with the with my own institution's HDI's official Twitter, and I also leverage with the university's research Twitter arm. And what do I mean by leverage? So if I want to promote a grant that I have, it's usually done by the university's research Twitter handle. If I want to promote a study, it's usually done through my organizational Twitter account. If I want to talk about grant activities, it is done through my university, through my institute's Twitter handle. It is not done through my account, because the followers of those accounts are really well curated. They're almost a brand. They have, you know, their mission is strong, their values are very explicit, and their social media messaging. They have an information, like the information services director and her team is actively working on managing an account. So I use those accounts when I'm trying to promote messages for participant recruitment. To use those official accounts, it's important that I build offline relationships. So I'm very, you know, I have I'm in constant communication with our institute's information services director and her team, so that I can coordinate social media messages for the grants that I oversee. So it's important, if you want to leverage organizational accounts, it's important to know, it's important to leverage those relationships in real life. So we have, as Anne mentioned, I also oversee the Kentucky State Pilot Paralysis Resource Center. So for winter activities, we want to post a host of wellness messages that are funded through the grant. So we have already, you know, developed a set of social media messages that will be posted on Facebook, on Twitter. It'll have, you know, it'll be well, you know, messaging is its own art. So the information services team will work on it. It will have, it makes sure that it's appropriately captioned for images, and it will be done well in advance so that when it's a time for the holidays, right before these social media messaging messages can come out. And this is actually works well for both ways. In my way, I don't have to spend time maintaining an official brand for myself. And I can just use my Twitter account for, you know, for information purposes for myself, and I can then use an organizational account for doing the actual work or promotion. And it works well for the institution's Twitter account because, you know, the sense that I am helping with their content. So just understand the mutual dependencies. Yes, you can join the Twitter conversation using appropriate hashtags. And that's always a great way. If you have ever missed a conversation, I often go back to conferences that I can't attend, and I just put their hashtag in to see what the conversation is and pick up on presentations that I might want to watch later. It's following organizational accounts and having those relationships with those account managers really helps us, really helps me balance, because this quite a bit of time is needed to manage a social media account, like how organizations do, and something most of us cannot afford to do. Participant recruitment. What I have found is, like, you know, Instagram influencers, there are some social media network influencers. These are the people who have a long-standing, established set of followers because they do good discourse, they promote good content, and they have a comprehensive list on any on a particular issue. It's important to make connections with those people as you're developing your research inquiry and as you're developing your research project. So we are working on a project where I know this person would be, you know, would be great because that's her passion. She has a great follower. That's her area of interest. And we brought her in as a research consultant way before the project started. And doing so, you are engaging as much. So you're engaging this person, has any collaborator, has any co-investigator. By doing so, you're building a relationship so that this person has buy-in, but they also have input on how to promote your research. It's also very easy to write an IRB. So all our social media messaging in terms of participant recruitment are approved by the university's promotional PR person. But also it's very easy to write an IRB when you're saying, these are the tweets that will be promoted by these accounts. So it's a very specific plan. It's a very specific route. And it's also, and you don't have to have, if you're establishing a relationship, you really don't have to have a social media platform. For example, a research that I did, I don't have a Facebook account, but I sent it to a colleague of mine who has a very active Facebook account to promote a message. It's okay to leverage those kinds of relationships and dependencies as well. Like, you don't have to have an account to promote your message or to recruit participants. As long as you have relationships with those people who have it, then you can bring them in. There are limitations, and social media is not the perfect platform for every study. For a recent study we did the old-fashioned way of using listservs, because the listserv was very curated. We were studying a particular issue on a particular region, and we knew these were the listservs, and we had an in with the listserv. So at the end of the day, it's like, who has the in and who has the big reach on the issue that you are studying? You can do real-time problem solving, especially if you have a close network of people whom you engage with either on Twitter or any other platform on a regular basis. You can, when you are doing the research, you can engage them either publicly or privately. If you do it publicly, there's pros and cons. It does allow everyone to give an opinion, which might be good or bad, but understand that you can use your listservs to do problem solving. In terms of dissemination, offer plain language summaries if possible. Yes, Twitter polls are a great way to get a pulse, especially if you have a really good set of followers who are very interested in your topic. Twitter polls are really fantastic. So know that problem solving can happen. And, you know, it's truly, there are pros and cons of doing it in a public platform or not. Engaging people with your work. So it is your choice. If people are talking about your work and they tag you, it is totally your choice whether you want to engage them or not. Because it happens in a public platform, the discourse is really different. You should know when to take it private. Know when to, if you are having an active discourse, you have to know when to take it to a private messaging, like in Twitter, it's direct messaging, or when to move it offline, totally go through email or phone. and sometimes know when to respond. There are some, you know, when people tag me on some articles, which was written, which I wrote years before, and my position has changed, I don't really respond or engage because I haven't had the time to publish the next set, to provide a nuanced take on it. Like, like publications, responses, you know, they're all situated within a context and time. So it's totally fine if you're not engaged in discourses about your work. And that's okay, because you want people to use your findings and think through and adapt them in different ways and reinvent the framework that you are working on. So, you know, as much as, like, I'm very open to changes, and I think that social media allows us to give, you know, you can see that happening, how people can take your work and they just transform it very differently, and that's totally fine. Again, curate your list. This is the time. People change. Their opinions change. Their interests change. I have been a person who was very much interested in a topic for 3 years, and afterwards I had to switch gears. And, you know, I can certainly understand if someone drops me off a particular list, because I'm like, you know, I haven't done an active contribution to that field. So it's okay to curate your list. And I strongly suggest that to do that often, because if you can think about, did your Twitter timeline has a magazine that you open daily, you want to read from people you like. You want to read with things that nourish you and amplify you and energize your work. So constantly curate your list. And again, these are just, you know, there's a lot of choice that we, in traditional formats, we don't have, that we do have on Twitter. So as an evaluator, I really thought hard about evaluating my social network. So for me, social media metrics don't matter. My number of followers is very less than the number of people I follow. I am not an influencer. What I mean, it's going back to what I initially said. I use it to inform inquiry, to make sure that I'm inclusive, that I'm hearing voices that I traditionally would not hear. And, you know, that's why for me, social media metrics don't matter. I often, you know, I follow a practice where I often delete my posts periodically. So some of my most, you know, popular posts are no longer there. It's just, for me, it's for my own research inquiry and understanding. It does provide a platform where you can really promote people's work whose traditional platforms don't allow. And it does provide an opportunity for meaningful connections. I have met people through Twitter that I've never met in real life. And I was been able to be a part of an international conversation around sense making during COVID. So these are things that I would have never done if I didn't make a meaningful connection through Twitter. So I know in this age of, you know, impressions and messaging, for an organizational and a brand account, that totally matters because you're spreading a message. But for me, for a researcher or a program evaluator who's trying to understand issues, this is a very personal information consumption. I'm engaging people in a more realistic, small way. So these social media metrics don't matter. That was my last slide. I am going to hand off the presentation to my colleague, Christina. Thank you.
Thank you, Chithra. Thanks for guiding us through thinking about social media and research. And good afternoon to all. And thanks again for having us today and for including accessibility and usability in this conversation. Technology is always changing, and changing at a particularly fast pace in these recent years. So it becomes difficult to keep up with how to do things and what features different platforms have. But the entire purpose, right, of social media is user engagement. So we're going to talk through some practical ways to make that engagement possible for the greatest number of people through the use of social networks and platforms. And so making these interactions as inclusive as possible provides the best experience for as many people possible. And also, I just love it. So thanks for having us today. First, we'll talk through some tips on how you guys are using your organizational accounts. It's really amazing to see that 90% of you are. That's excellent. And also just another way that we're showing how things are growing and changing at such a quick pace. But I'll start with stating what most of you probably already know. Accessibility is required, especially for those of us who receive federal funding, right? And it sounds like that's the case for many of us on the call today. So that's specifically Section 508 of the Rehab Act, and that requires that federal agencies' electronic and information technology is accessible to people with disabilities, and that includes employees of those agencies and also members of the public. So it pretty much covers everyone there. And then also through the ADA, through the Access to Information and Technology. Next is just to protect your organization with a social media policy. And a social media policy is a document that outlines how your organization and the employees within your organization should conduct themselves online, right? So it really should align with your values, statements, and the role of your organization. If you don't have one yet, there are a lot of free templates and examples online. Just a quick Google search will give you a lot of examples of what some social media policies look like. And then next, link to your web accessibility policy. Include a link to your social media from your social media account back to your organizational web accessibility policy or statement to online accessibility. It might be a standalone statement. It might be something that's already integrated into your non-discrimination or equal opportunity statements. Okay, you guys. And then the next one is just to make your contact information available. It's something that I think a lot of people miss. You don't want people to have to dig around to figure out how to get a hold of you or how to contact you. List a primary phone number and an email address where a user can reach your agency or organization with questions, or provide a link to your agency website that might list the appropriate contact information. You just really want to provide an easy point of entry for more information. Some of the most common ways are to post threads on your website, provide options for people to sign up for a daily email digest of social media posts, or to add a social media widget to your agency website. And there's most sites will have the widgets that link to your social media accounts. And then lastly, test your accounts. You can use tools like the Wave tool I've included a link to, which is part of WebAIM, to identify the web accessibility, the web content accessibility guideline errors, and to get guidance on how to correct those errors. Wave is a web-based tool, but they also have extensions for both Chrome and Firefox that make it really easy to walk through each one of your pages and each one of your social media pages as well. Another one is called AXE, it's A-X-E, and it's another extension that does a great job assessing what needs to be fixed and has great resources that link within your results on why and how to fix errors that it's flagging, as well as how impactful or important the errors that are being flagged are to address. Now we're gonna talk through some of the more common issues related to accessibility in social media. Missing section headings. So a lack of section headings are a feature that are often missed or overlooked. And section headings are very important for those using screen readers to engage with your page. This is definitely one of the more common errors that you'll see initially as you're using a tool to check the errors, but also one that's really easy to fix once you know how. Poor color contrast. That's also an error result you'll notice when you start to check pages with a tool like Wave. Meeting the minimum contrast ratio allows people with low vision with color blindness to be able to view content that they couldn't otherwise see. The ratio between text color and background should be at least it's 4.5 to 1, but the guidelines and the contrast checkers will give you what your ratio is at and show you how to correct that. Like for example, green and red or blue and yellow combinations are often really difficult to read. Text is difficult to read when it's imposed over images. So just setting a solid background behind text makes it more accessible. Some pages don't have the ability to navigate or operate functions using just the keyboard. So that's for people who are unable to utilize a mouse for whatever reason. missing alt text for images. So alternative text or alt text provides a description for any image or non-text feature. And is another example of a really common error that's easy to integrate into your process with a little bit of practice. WebAIM calls this one the most problematic aspect of web accessibility, the missing alt text. And so it's also obviously really important for people with low to no vision, anyone using a screen reader, or reading a page in any other navigable fashion. Some people are able to interact with content through using a zoom text feature, so they can enlarge the text or whatever image it might be on their screen. So we need to make sure that the ability to resize text is in existence, and that's a common issue of it not being. Yes, I will direct to a resource for what should be included in alt text. I have several resources linked in this presentation because they've already been created. So I use them regularly and have included them here for you all to use them regularly too. But one of the other common issues is that videos still lack captioning. And so we know that's been an ongoing one for quite a while, but there are many more ways to address that we'll also discuss briefly here. So now we're going to spend a little time talking about some action steps, talking about the flip side of the errors. How do we create accessible content? So we're going to go through some tips and best practices over these next few slides on how to do that. Number one, include captions. Captions are critical for viewers with hearing impairment, but also for diverse learners, non-native language viewers, people learning to read, and other viewers not using sound for any reason. Maybe they're just in a setting that sound is not possible. So there are a lot of ways to do this these days, and it's becoming more integrated, cheaper, and just overall easier to make sure that we do have captions and even transcripts from things that we have to provide people. There are several artificial intelligence or AI platforms to use to capture audio that will convert to text. So that's speech to text. And those are a really good starting point from which to edit a final version. They are so much more reliable and accurate than they were 2 years ago, especially 5 or 10 years ago. The next one is to use image descriptions, right? And so there's a lot of online resources to practice how to write succinct image descriptions for any non-text items in your posts. Several platforms, several social media platforms have built-in auto alt text features, which is also a really great starting point. But I'd still like to encourage everyone to be sure to review and edit for the most effective use of those. We want to convey the content. So that's the full goal of the image description, right? We want to try to not start with an image of or a photograph of, because that's kind of the premise already, is that we're describing something that is an image or photograph. So we want to mention the color if it's important. In image descriptions, we want to try to use the humor and convey the humor that's present. It doesn't have to be too formal. We want to express what's funny in an image. And then don't forget to offer alt text for GIFs as well. Sometimes those aren't recognized as traditional image, but to have a description of what's happening in that GIF is really good as well. And yes, Hootsuite in particular is a really good place to start with good suggestions for alt text and image descriptions also, not just to manage content. They have also addressed these huge issues of accessibility in their software as well. We want to limit emoji and emoticon use in our posts. These, when they are used with a screen reader, are read aloud by a screen reader. So they can be really distracting when all of a sudden in the middle of a post or something that your screen reader is reading aloud, it says loudly crying face or give some other description. So at the very least, before you do use emoticons or emojis, try to determine what the screen reader and what the alt text is behind that will be read aloud to somebody. Using camel case for multi-word hashtags. So this one's a really good one too. That makes sense for a lot of different reasons, but using camel case for multiple words within a hashtag. And so that is capitalizing the first letter of compound words. It just makes it easier visually for all of us and allows for screen readers to pronounce individual words more clearly when they're, smashed together in a hashtag. Don't embed text in images. A screen reader doesn't recognize the text since it's then become part of the image. There are Lots of different ways to do that. But and then the last one is to use, or not the last one, last one on this slide is to use link shortening services. So there are a lot of these available as well. There's probably a list of 10, but they are services like Bitly, Tiny URL. And what these do is they convert those long URL web addresses into short, more descriptive and addresses, right? So you can more clearly align what the Bitly link is to your page or to your post or to whatever it is you're going to by using the actual words from that site rather than a long otherwise a non-descriptive web address. We want to place hashtags and mentions. They're really important tools in social media, but we want to make sure that we put them at the end of the post, not within the post. Having them within a post really complicates comprehension for different groups of people and also for screen readers. So when you're in the middle of a post or of a thought or of a sentence, to have a hashtag read or a mention read just makes it less universally comprehensible. If tweets contain an image, video, or audio, it's best practice to indicate these at the beginning of the content using a prefix in parentheses, like pick video or audio to describe that that's going to be coming. We want to avoid acronyms, right? In our field in particular, I know there are millions of acronyms that we have and learn, but we want to avoid acronyms and abbreviations and text messaging shortcuts, especially on platforms like Facebook, which don't have any character limits, right? They provide the space. And so that's just a really good tool across all of your writing in terms of plain language use, which we'll talk about in a minute here too. But just to be able to let people understand in a more accessible way what you're talking about. And along that same line, we don't want to overuse full caps, right? And so we use that a lot for emphasis, but they can be difficult to read and they can be misinterpreted by screen readers. And so try to minimize at least the use of words in full caps. I know I'm seeing this practice used more and more on Twitter as an effort to be more descriptive, but sending a follow-up tweet with an image or video description or a follow-up tweet with additional information, right? So Twitter will indicate what number of the how many that tweet represents in terms of 1 of 3, 2 of 3, 3 of 3, et cetera. And so that's a great tool to use to follow up with maybe your hashtags or with your mentions, with a description or with more information. Enabling image description, the image description feature on Twitter. And this is a really good example of how the common issue list is being integrated into social media platforms, where Twitter offers an auto image description to review and edit. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the use of plain language. And this is really important in our world and in just the accessibility and being understood in our posts, right? So plain language use is best practice, again, just for the widest number of users. It just works better for people who are skimming content, for people who require the principles of plain language to maximize their comprehension. Plain language use is clear, concise, well-organized. And key best practices for writing in plain language include choosing words that are common and easy to understand, avoiding run-on sentences, so using clear, short sentences and paragraphs, and writing in the active voice instead of the passive voice. So passive voice, for example, would be applications for the job were submitted by 100 people, whereas active voice would be 100 people submitted applications for the job. So really just making it an action rather than not. And then another way to do this is sticking with gender-neutral pronouns, right? It just makes it a simpler, wider base to understand. And thank you, Shoshana. I do actually include these two links that she's put in the chat right here. So we've got this checklist for plain language use on the web. And so it's a quick list, but it's a really good list of reminders, not assuming readers have knowledge of the subject. So clearly explain things on each page, not using the click here as a link. The link language should describe what your reader will get if they go to that link. Using lots of lists and even more lists than you do on paper. But I think this is a good one to reference back to as you're thinking through how ways to use plain language. And then the make your messages effective. So the 5-step checklist provided by the Center for Plain Language is another great resource for us to be using and referencing back to. And then you can also use plain language checkers, right? So you can check the readability of everything that we're creating, all the content we're creating, for use on social media platforms and in other ways that we're using written language as well. So the 5-step checklist includes identifying and describing the target audience and walking you through how to look at that audience group, structuring the content to guide the reader through it, writing the content in plain language, and then also talks through how to pick the right words, and then have some examples on where to look for more information regarding that too. Really quickly, wanted to talk a little bit also about ableist language use. And so while plain language use is something that we want to do, ableist language use is what we want to avoid. We know that the words that we use hold power and express attitudes and beliefs behind them. There's a lot of guidance available around the etiology and language and the terminology related to disability. But ableism is the systemic exclusion and oppression of people with disability, often expressed and reinforced through language. It's language that is offensive, derogatory, abusive, or negative about disability. And most often, it is not intentional. These are colloquialisms. This is language that has been used in our lives historically, or that the people that we know have historically used. But it does project the idea that disability reflects as less than, and that is not true, and that is not what we believe. And so I just included a list from Wikipedia of some disability terms with the etiology. And as a starting point, to really look into some of those words and analyze and think about some of the words that we use that we should hold under consideration in our spoken and written vocabulary. But that really does feed into this discussion around the language we use and around accessibility and how we want to be presenting our organizations and our work in social media. Social media accessibility. So progress is being made. Like I said, technology is changing so quickly. It's really hard to keep up with what the features are and what we need to be paying attention to. And it can be overwhelming. But Twitter didn't have a paid accessibility team. It was all volunteer based, and they were publicly called out just this summer. And I think partially because so many more of us are using social media and different platforms for interaction and engagement right now in the days of COVID. But they have now established 2 accessibility teams and have plans to roll out automated captions early next year. Instagram didn't have alt tags for images. They didn't have the functionality to be able to add them. But now they not only have that, but they have an alt text, an auto alt text, and a custom alt text. So again, that's something that you want to go in and look at and make sure you're reviewing for accuracy. Sometimes they can be pretty hilarious with the automated systems come up with. So we want to make sure that they reflect what we're trying to get across in those platforms. But also now all 3 platforms and LinkedIn have alt image description fields available. So that is all progress for Twitter, Instagram, and the other platforms. Automatic captioning is now available on Facebook Live and Instagram IGTV. And so that again is that AI captioning that is a really great starting point and is so much more reliable and can learn in ways that we didn't have access to that technology in the past. And those who are active in social media, and especially in your organizational accounts, should view staying updated on these social media platform updates as one of the responsibilities, truly. We need to get familiar with the social media site's own support and access tips. So I've included the links for both Facebook accessibility and Twitter accessibility here. And then we're always trying to think about what can we do, right? What can we do to make things better? We want to make sure that we're talking to people who are using different ways of accessing and talking to people coming from different places accessing social media. And we want to continue to find ways to ask for more accessibility. We want to use their platforms to be asking for accessibility and use our organizational platforms and reputations as well to be requesting more accessibility and then repeat, right? We know that that is part of the game. We have to keep repeating. We have to keep advocating to get those needed access features integrated and to keep up with what is available that can help people truly be able to participate and engage in these platforms. So look into Facebook and Instagram and keep up with what their accessibility practices are and make sure that they know what our accessibility concerns are. And then I've included some more tools here. I've included a usability.gov site in terms of accessibility and the digitalgov.gov site in addition to WebAIM. And so I know that you guys can all click to those and that Shoshana is doing an excellent job keeping them posted in the chat. So the usability.gov page has a lot of wonderful tools. And templates and documents, but the tools around how to do all these things, and they will keep those updated. So it's a great place to go to know what the current issues are and what the new features are and how to keep asking and implementing those. And then the digital.gov, it again has that link to the plain language page, how to test websites for accessibility. And so that can also be used on your social media pages. Improving the accessibility of social media in government is another good tool that they have. And then the web accessibility guidelines, that's the WCAG. And so that's the standard for web content accessibility. And they are continually doing work to promote and grow that across all platforms. And then the WebAIM, like I said, that is where you can get to the WAVE tool. So having that extension downloaded onto your Chrome or Firefox will help you identify any of the accessibility features that are missing currently. And so it's all really positive stuff to doing this work that is necessary for all of us to be participating in to make things more usable for everyone. Please. So that is Chithra's and I's contribution to today's discussion around social media platforms. And we'll turn it back to Anne.